Good evening. We'd like to welcome you to the Fairview Christian Academy Spring Concert. As I was driving up Fairview Road, I noticed the Bradford pear trees were starting to blossom a little bit, so it's starting to be like spring, except it's supposed to snow Saturday morning. Is that what I heard? Flurries on Saturday morning. Hey, we'd like to welcome you to our concert. Each of these students here have worked hard to perfect their speech or their song, and most of them are going to be heading over to Murfreesboro in a couple weeks for competition. So this is just another chance for them to practice for you and be able to showcase what they've been working on all year. So we're going to have a word of prayer, and as soon as I'm done praying, we'll begin our program. Dear Jesus, we do love you, and I thank you so much for Christian education. I thank you for the impact that it has made in not only my life, but the lives of these students. Father, I pray as we have this program tonight, that each thing will be done in a way that brings glory to you. And I ask this in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so sit back and enjoy the show.
I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and I'll be reciting Miguel Gets Pool by Dr. Seuss.
Young man, laughed the farmer, you're sort of a fool. You'll never catch fish in Miguel Gets Pool. The pool's too small, and you might as well know it. When people have junk, here's the place they throw it. You might catch a boot, or you might catch a can. You might catch a bottle. But listen, young man, if you sat 50 years with your worms and your wishes, you grow a long beard long before you catch fishes. Answered Marco. It may be you're right. I've been here 3 hours without one single bite. There might be no fish, but again, well, there might, because you never can tell what goes on down below. This pool might be bigger than you or I know. This might be a pool, like I've read of in books, connected to one of those underground brooks, an underground river that starts here and flows right under the pasture. And then, well, who knows? It might go along down where no one can see, right under State Highway 203, right under the wagons, right under the toes of Mrs. Ambroso, who's hanging out clothes. It might keep on flowing, perhaps. Who can tell? Right under the people in Sanitan's Hotel, right under the grass where they're playing croquet, then under the mountains and far, far away. This might be a river. Now, mightn't it be connecting Miguel Gets Pool with the sea? Then maybe some fish might be swimming toward me. If such a thing could be, they certainly would be. Some very smart fellow might point out the way to the place where I'm fishing. And that's why I say, if I wait long enough, if I'm patient and cool, who knows what I'll catch in Miguel Gets Pool? I might catch a thin fish. I might catch a stout fish. I might catch a short or a long, long drawn out fish. Any kind, any shape, any color or size. I might catch some fish that would open your eyes. I won't be surprised if a dogfish appears, complete with a collar and long floppy ears, woofing along. And perhaps he might chase a whole lot of catfish right straight to this place. I might catch a seahorse. Now, mightn't I now? I might catch a fish who's partly a cow. I might catch an eel. Well, I might, it depends. A long twisting eel with a lot of strange bends. And oddly enough, with a head on both ends. One doesn't catch this kind of fish as a rule. But the chances are fine in Miguel Gets Pool. Oh, the sea is so full of a number of fish. if a fellow is patient, he might get his wish. And that's why I think that I'm not such a fool when I sit here and fish in McGilligan's pool.
Great, and today I will be singing By Faith by the Gettys.
Hello, my name is John Thomas Acuff. I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and today I'll be reciting President George W. Bush's remarks on September 11th, 2002. Good evening. A long year has passed since enemies attacked our country. We've seen the images so many times they are seared on our souls. And remembering the horror, reliving the anguish, reimagining the terror is hard and painful. For those who lost loved ones, it's been a year of sorrow, of empty places, of newborn children who will never know their fathers here on earth. For members of our military, it's been a year of sacrifice and service far from home. For all Americans, it's been a year of adjustment, of coming to terms with the difficult knowledge that our nation has determined enemies and that we are not invulnerable to their attacks. Yet, in the events that have challenged us, we have also seen the character that will deliver us. We have seen the greatness of America and airline passengers who defied their hijackers and ran a plane into the ground to spare the lives of others. We have seen the greatness of America and rescuers who rushed up flights of stairs towards peril, and we continue to see the greatness of America and the care and compassion our citizens show to each other. September 11th, 2001 will always be a fixed point in the life of America. The loss of so many lives left us to examine our own. Each of us was reminded that we are here only for a time, and that these come the days should be filled with things that last and matter. Love for our families, love for our neighbors, and for our country, gratitude for life and to the giver of life. We resolved a year ago to honor every last person lost. We owe them remembrance, and we owe them more. We owe them and their children and our own the most enduring monument we can build, a world of liberty and security made possible by the way America leads and by the way Americans lead their lives. The attack on our nation was also an attack on the ideals that make us a nation. Our deepest natural conviction is that every life is precious, because every life is the gift of a creator who intended us to live in liberty and equality. More than anything else, this separates us from the enemy we fight. We value every life. Our enemies value none, not even innocent, not even their own. And we seek the freedom and opportunity that give meaning and value to life. There is a line in our time, in every time, between those who believe that all men are created equal and those who believe that some men and women and children are expendable in the pursuit of power. There is a line in our time, and every time, between the defenders of human liberty and those who seek to master the minds and souls of others. Our generation has now heard history's call, and we will answer it. The attack on our nation. America has entered a great struggle that tests our strength and even more our resolve. Our nation is patient and steadfast. We continue to pursue the terrorists in cities and camps and caves across the earth. We are joined by a great coalition of nations to rid the world of terror. We will not allow any terrorist or tyrant to threaten civilization with weapons of mass murder. Now and in the future, Americans will live as a free people, not in fear, and never at the mercy of any foreign plot or power. This nation has defeated tyrants and liberated death camps. Raise this lamp of liberty to every captive land. We have no intention of ignoring or appeasing history's latest gang of fanatics trying to murder the way to power. They are discovering, as others before them, the resolve of a great country and a great democracy in the ruins of two towers under a flag unfurled at the Pentagon. At the funerals of the lost, we have made a sacred promise to ourselves and to the world. We will not relent until justice is done and our nation is secure. What our enemies have begun, we will finish. I believe there is a reason that history has matched this nation with this time. America strives to be tolerant and just. We fight not to impose our will, but to defend ourselves and extend the blessings of freedom. We cannot know all that lies ahead, yet we do know that God has placed us together in this moment. To grieve together, to stand together, to serve each other and our country. And the duty we have been given, defending America and our freedom, is a privilege that we all share. We're prepared for this journey, and our prayer tonight is that God will see us through and keep us worthy. Tomorrow is September the 12th. A milestone has passed, and the mission goes on. Be confident. Our country is strong, and our cause is even larger than our country. Ours is the cause of human dignity, freedom guided by conscience and guarded by peace. This ideal of America is the hope of all mankind. That hope drew millions to this harbor. That hope still lights our way. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. May God bless America.
Vocal ensemble, and we will be singing "For Me to Live is Christ" by Matt Herbster.
My name is Levi Reese. I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and I'll be performing "Light the World" by Sarah Lynn Barrow. Savior's call.
My name is Maggie Petty. I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and I will be performing Mrs. Stein by Bill Dodds. The school bell rings. We go inside. Our teacher isn't there. Maybe she's sick, her pet cries out. Yeah, right, as if I'd care. I have a D in language arts. My grade in math's the same, and now my teacher might be sick. Could be I'm part to blame. She doesn't like me. That's a fact. I wouldn't tell a lie. She says stuff like, "You're very smart, but you don't even try." I start to laugh. My teacher's sick. And boy, I'm feeling fine when someone knocks the door right in. And there stands Frankenstein. She's 6'8". Her dress is black. She's wearing combat boots. I start to gasp. She growls and says, "I'll be your substitute." The teacher's pet is whimpering. She doesn't stand a chance. The smart kid stares and points, faints. The bully wets his pants. "My name is Mrs. Stein," she says, and every student cringes. She leans the door against the wall. She's knocked it off its hinges. "Now, let's begin. You there, stand up." She looks me in the eye. I try to move. My legs won't work. I know I'm going to die. In one big step, she's next to me. She does more than hover. She blocks the sun. It's dark as night. My classmates run for cover. Now get up to the board, she says. I'd like to see some action. Pick up the chalk, explain to us division of a fraction. I leap away to save my life. This time, I really try. I think and think and think and croak, invert and multiply. Correct, she says. I breathe again and head back for my chair. "You freeze," she shouts, and I stop cold. "And don't go anywhere."
anywhere. This all begins at 9 o'clock. I fight to stay alive. It seems to last a million years. The clock says 9:05. That's just 300 seconds. And then my turn is through. She points at every one of us. Now you, now you, now you. We all get nailed this awful day. There's nowhere we can hide. The lunch bell rings. We cannot eat. We simply crawl outside. We can't believe the other kids who run and play their games. Not us who have Big Mrs. Stein. Our world is not the same. The bell has tolled. I must go in. My time on Earth is through. I'll leave this on the playground, and here's what you have to do. You must listen to your teacher and pray her health is fine, or one day soon you'll hear the words, "My name is Mrs. Stein."
Hi, my name is Cole Jackson from Fairview Christian Academy. I am in 10th grade, and today I will be singing "The Holy City" by Stephen Adams.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the moon was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away.
My name is Mackenzie Loudon. I'm from Fairview Christian Academy in Athens, Tennessee, and I will be reciting The Birthday by Margaret E. Sangster. The boy sat quite alone on the hilltop, his shepherd's crook across his knees, his small square lunch basket beside him. The shawl of the lamb's wool could not hide the ugly hump that lay between his shoulders. Far below him were the sheep. His eyes were fixed up on the sky. Perhaps it'll happen again. Perhaps I shall see the great star and hear the angel voices as my father did. It was the time of the anniversary. How often the boy had listened to the story. The boy's father had come to the stable in the inn where he had seen a woman with a baby in her arms. Scarcely an hour old, when first I glimpsed him, I found myself kneeling, and there were tears on my face. Many of us thought the child had been slain by Herod, but there are some who say he's become a Messiah who performs wonderful deeds, healing the halt and the blind and the lepers, even raising the dead. The boy interrupted. I would that I might meet him. I would that he might take the hump from my back and make me straight like those other children. The boy judged it to be midnight, for at that time he could break for lunch. It's good to be hungry, yes, and to have food. From somewhere just behind him, a voice spoke. Indeed, yes, it is good to be hungry, and to have food, and to startle. The boy glanced behind him and saw a man. You're a stranger, sir? No, not a stranger. As it happens, my journey started not far from this very place. I was about to eat my lunch. I'm a shepherd, sir. Will you be seated and break bread with me? I long for some companionship. It's a strange coincidence that you're a shepherd, for I also tend my father's flock, and I also have often grown lonely. Are you sure you have enough for two? Yes, I have a large glass of goat's milk, some yellow cheese, and nearly a loaf of bread, and 10 figs. He didn't mention the cake. It was a rare delicacy, and it wasn't a very big cake. How long have you been crippled? Why, I've never been without a hump between my shoulder. I hate it. It's hard going through life looking like one of the camels that the wise men rode when they came east. What? Lad, do you know of the wise men of the East? I suppose the wise men are on my mind because it is the time of the anniversary, and I've been thinking of the baby born in the stable. I was hoping that once again the great star might shine and the angels might sing. What do you know of these holy things, of the star and the song? You're so very young. Oh, Bethlehem heard about the star and about the infant who lay in the manger. My father was one of the shepherds who saw the great light from the heavens and heard the angel music. How old, sir, are you? I'm 10 years old. It's odd that you should ask, for this is my day of birth. You quite unknowing are giving me an anniversary feast. You haven't people whom you can make merry on your day of birth? I fear I have grown too old and large for a birthday gift, but maybe there will be a gift for me at my journey's end. When, sir, will you come to your journey's end? Perhaps very soon. You don't look happy about it. Don't you want to come to the end of your travels? Yes, I want to reach home. I should be getting on now. You have made this birthday very sweet, my lad. You've not had a true birthday feast? I have a cake I was saving to eat alone. I desire to give the cake to you as my gift. Oh, my lad, we will share this cake, my birthday cake. So he and the boy sat and ate the cake together. Oh, don't leave me, sir. We could be such friends. You and I, don't journey on, sir. Stay with me here in Bethlehem. I must go on. I must be about my father's business, but I shall never leave you, my lad. lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Bowing his head, covering his misted eyes, the boy was aware of the man's firm fingers troubling up his shoulders until they touched his hair. When he raised his head, the man was gone. The boy sobbed once with a sense of loss, and then he struggled to his feet. Only he didn't have to struggle, for there was a curious lightness about his body. But it wasn't until he drew his shawl tighter across his back that he realized how straight he was standing and how straight he would always stand.
Hello, my name is Levi Petty. I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and today I will be reciting Sweet Tooth by Margie Palatini. This is Stuart, your typical, average, everyday kid, except for one thing. Little air. There it is, all right. The molar in the back. This is no ordinary tooth. This is Stuart's sweet tooth. One nagging, annoying, demanding, blah, blah, blah. Enough with the yakking. I need a candy bar. Now! Very loud sweet tooth. Does it have that gooey stuff in the middle? Because it's got to have that gooey stuff in the middle. There, said Stuart, the smeared kisser in a gulp, satisfied. Ah, sweet. Yes, a tooth that wants what it wants, when it wants it, and lets everybody know it. For example, 2 years ago, at Cousin Charlotte's wedding, Stuart was on his best behavior. Shoes were shined, his bow tie was straight. Grandpa had just lifted his glass to toast the bride and groom. I'm falling asleep here. Come on. Move it along, Gramps. Cut the cake. Time to cut the cake. I want that end hunk with all that icing. I don't know him, uttered Mother through a gritted smile. He doesn't belong to me, said Dad under his breath. Who is that boy? Muttered Grandmother. Stuart wiped his lips. It's the sweet tooth. It was not a pretty picture. The tooth was no better behaved in school. Stuart had enough detention slips to wallpaper his room. Why, just 2 weeks ago. Who can tell me the capital of North Dakota? Asked Miss Finnegan in geography class.
Jelly beans,
said a muffled voice from the back of the room. Did you say something, Stuart? Asked Miss Finnegan.
Licorice.
Stuart, I'm afraid I can't hear your answer.
Lollipops.
You're going to have to speak up, Stuart.
Hey, I'm dying here for a couple of chocolate-covered peanut butter cups, okay?
Detention slip number 432.
But I'm telling you, it's not me, said Stuart as she was led away to the principal's office. It's the tooth.
Of course, there was the unforgettable Easter basket mishap. That Sunday morning, the family awoke to find jelly beans littering the living room. Marshmallow chicks were missing. The trail of crumpled yellow foil wrappers led to one person and one person only. Oh, Stuart, cried a disappointed mom and dad.
I can't look,
whimpered his sister Allison, closing her eyes. Those chocolate bunnies never had a chance, moaned Stuart, rubbing his belly-aching stomach. It was the tooth.
Hey, can we stop going down memory lane here and open up that bag of cookies?
No more cookies. No more candy. No more cake. No more nothing.
Who do you think you're kidding, kid? Come on, bring on those chocolate chips.
Stuart sighed. What choice did he have? He was a boy with one big sweet tooth. He tore open the bag. He grabbed one, then two, three, four cookies. He opened his mouth. "Come to Papa!" shouted the tooth. Stuart stopped. "What are you waiting for, kid? Come on. Cookie, 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 cookie." Stuart dropped the cookies, but not in his mouth. "It's over, Tooth. I'm cutting you off, starting right now. It's cold turkey."
"Cold turkey? Yuck, I hate cold turkey."
"Unless you had a little cranberry sauce." "Didn't you hear me? I said, it's over. From now on, there's nothing for you but a healthy diet."
"Healthy? Kid, say you don't mean it."
But Stuart meant it all right. He meant every word. Yes, it was trying. Yes, it was difficult. Okay, it was near impossible. But Stuart stayed strong. For the tooth, it was a different story.
"You're giving me peas? Little dry green veggie marbles? Broccoli? You're feeding me a shrub? That's not gonna do it, kid. Dessert. Where's dessert? I'm begging ya. When do we get to the good stuff?"
"I can't hear you," said Stuart, putting down his fork and placing his hands over his ears. Strong. He stayed strong. 3 days passed. The tooth was quiet, very quiet. But Stuart was thinking baseball. It was the biggest game of the season. Bottom of the ninth, Stuart was at the plate. Runners were on second and third. 2 outs, 2 strikes. The game was on the line. Stuart's team was down by 1 run. A big, fat fastball was heading for the plate. It was all up to Stuart. And then, boy, can I go for a hunk of bubblegum right now. Swing, swish.
"Strike 3, yelled the umpire. "You're out."
"Gotcha. Now, go give me some goodies."
"I'll get you goodies," mumbled Stuart, dropping the bat. Home he marched, into the kitchen, straight for the refrigerator. He yanked open the door. He flung lettuce, he tossed tomatoes, he hurled a head of cauliflower, and then he pulled out a carrot. That's right, a carrot. "It's over for you, Tooth," announced Stuart, defiantly lifting the carrot above his head.
"What are you gonna do with that?"
asked his wide-eyed sister. Stuart grinned. He opened his mouth wide, very wide.
"No, kid, not the carrot, not the carrot."
"Yes, the carrot."
"No, kid, no."
Closer, 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 and then crunch.
Way to go, done in by a orange veggie.
It was over. "What's gonna happen to it?" asked Allison as she followed her brother upstairs to the bedroom. Stuart placed the molar under his pillow, then looked at his sister. "Who knows? That's the tooth fairy's problem now."
my name is Claire Petty. I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and today I will be reciting The Silver Coin by Laurel Hicks. J. Hudson Taylor, the famous missionary to China, was known as the man who depended completely on God for all his needs. He is called the Father of Faith Missions. He did not tell people about his needs. Instead, he told God about it in prayer and asked God to move people to give as much as was needed. He knew God had called him to China, and he began to prepare himself by working for a Christian doctor in England. He wanted to learn all he could about medicine to better minister to the Chinese people. Hudson had a real test of faith one time. To practice enduring hardness, Hudson left the comfortable home where lodging and meals had been provided for him and moved into a part town where the poorer people lived. And by living with these people, he could better know how to meet their spiritual needs. With the money he saved by living here, he could help their physical needs also. Hudson had a real test of faith one time when the doctor for whom he worked for forgot to pay him. I will not remind him. Instead, I'll ask God to remind him. I know my Heavenly Father will take care of me. Days went by, and still Hudson had no paycheck. After paying his landlady on Saturday night, he found that all he had left was one silver coin called a half crown. It was worth perhaps a dollar in our money. He checked his cupboard and found he had food to last him through Monday morning. The half crown will buy my lunch and dinner on Monday. I'll just keep asking God for the money I'll need for the rest of the week. The next day was Sunday, and Hudson went to church as usual. In the afternoon and evening, Hudson visited the poor people around him, telling them of God's love for them. He saw a sad, weary-looking man shuffling toward him. "Please, sir," the man pleaded, "will you come to my home and pray with my wife? She is seriously ill, and I fear she will not live until morning." "I will come and do what I can," Hudson replied. The stranger turned into a courtyard Hudson recognized. How could he forget his last visit here? The occupants of the shabby rooms tore up his tracks and told him to never come back with his Jesus preaching. "If we see you here again, you'll be sorry," they shouted. "And here I am again," thought Hudson, "with a man whose story may or may not be true." He sighed. A door creaked open, and four or five ragged, barefoot children with sunken cheeks and grimy, torn clothes were standing in the drafty room or lying on the floor. "Poor things," thought Hudson. "They'll starve to death if no one helps them." He fingered the silver coin in his pocket. "If only I had smaller change for my half crown, surely I would give 3/4 of it to this needy family." He saw a woman lying on a straw mattress. A tiny baby, less than 2 days old, lay moaning at her side. It was clear that neither of them could live without food. Hudson began to tell the family of God's love for them. "Don't worry, just trust in God for all your needs." In his heart, Hudson heard God chiding him. "Hudson Taylor, why are you telling these poor people to trust in me when you don't even believe I can take care of you without the help of the silver coin in your pocket? If only I had smaller change, surely I would give half of it to this needy family." He knelt down to pray aloud for the family, but he had a hard time finding words. Rising from his knees, he turned to face the father. "Please, sir," the man pleaded, "you see what a desperate state we are in. If you can help us, please do, for the sake of your Lord." The words of Jesus flashed in Hudson's mind. "Give unto him that asketh thee." Slowly, Hudson reached out and pulled out the silver coin and handed it to the man. "It's not much, but believe me, it is all that I have. What I've been telling you is true. God is a loving Father, and He can be trusted. Immediately, the burden on his heart was gone, and joy flooded his soul. His supper of watery oatmeal before bed seemed to him a feast fit for a prince. The next morning, Hudson sat down to finish the last of his oatmeal. He heard the postman knock on the outside door. Soon, his landlady came in and handed him a small package. There was no note or letter inside, just a pair of new gloves. He pulled them out to examine them. Something fell with a ringing sound on the floor. "What was that?" he said aloud. "A gold coin? Why, this is four times as much as a silver coin I gave away. Thank you, Lord. You do keep your word, and I can trust you not only with my money, but with my life too."
My name is J.C. Taylor, I'm in the 10th grade, and I'll be reciting Grocery Store Express Line by Jeannie Robertson. In our area of the country, when somebody gets sick that we know or has passed, we take over food. If we take over food, you can buy that food, go to the grocery store, get something great, but put it down in the big list of important things for life. You get a lot more credit if you make it yourself. You can put it on your grandmother's platter, but the women in the kitchen will say, "I know where she got that chicken." I'm telling you, it works out that way. I make only one thing, and that is small little 7-Up pound cakes, and I make them by the dozen. I'm out of town, something happens, my husband takes it over. And not long ago, I got up one morning and heard that a friend of ours was sick. And I went to my freezer, and my pound cakes were depleted. I did not realize I was out. My husband said, I've been taking them to a lot of people. A lot of people been sick. Well, I didn't know they were gone. I got to get a pound cake made before I leave town. Honey, go to the grocery store and get my ingredients. He said, I'm trying to get to badminton. Well, it's just a few ingredients. I tell you what, I can get there and get it and still get to badminton, but you make sure I can get through that express line. No problem. We don't go to the grocery store together anymore because I frankly don't care how much things cost by the half ounce. So I made up the list and he left. Well, y'all, I waited. He didn't come back. I thought, he's gone on to badminton. Now where could he be? I was getting ready to call the grocery store when I heard the car pull in. He came huffing up the steps, had two sacks and more sacks hanging on his arms, and he just glared at me, started putting stuff down, and said, I'll get some more out of the car. I looked in the first sack, and there was a pound of margarine and two gigantic bottles of vanilla flavoring. It would take forever to get rid of those two gigantic bottles. In the next sack were 3 dozen eggs. I didn't need but 5 eggs. And in the next sack was a big old tub thing of shortening, 2 of them. And in the next sack were 2 more 12 pounds of lard. We could fry fish for everybody in here. But in that 4th sack, I found my list. In my eagerness to make sure that he could get through that express line for probably the first time in my life, I numbered the items on my list. Number 1, a pound of butter. No problem. Number 2, large bottle of vanilla flavoring. And I had 2 of them. Number 3, a dozen eggs. Yep. Number 4, a big old tub thing of lard. Yep, again. I could hear him coming back. I looked down at number 5. It said a 5-pound bag of sugar. So I knew he was coming back with 25 pounds of sugar. Number 6, 5-pound bag of all-purpose flour. 30 pounds of flour. I put that list behind my back. He came in again, plopping down sugar and flour all over. Bam, 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 bam. Gets it all down and says, one more trip. I looked down at number 7, a bottle of 7-Up. I told him that I wanted a 6-pack of those medium-sized ones hanging. So I knew he was coming back with 42 bottles of 7-Up. And in a minute, there it was. He turned around to me before he left and said, well, obviously they wouldn't let me through the express line. But you know what? He got all the way out in the hall, turned around and came back and said, for the record, I'd remembered what I'd done. But by then, she was ringing up the 7-Up and all these people behind me in line were laughing and I gotta get to badminton. Don't tell anybody. I won't. 3 days later, I went to the grocery store, and a woman checking me out says, I think I checked out your husband a few days ago. I'm sure you could have. That was an interesting order. Let me explain to you. Whenever a friend of ours gets sick or has passed, I make a pound cake and take it over. This woman says to me, was there an epidemic?
We are the small vocal ensemble from Fairview Christian Academy, and we will be singing Nothing But the Blood by Mark Crawford.
You may have sacrificed for
your time in seeking humanity's applause. Others have made long journeys through strange and distant lands, all searching for the answers in the heart of man. I too have tried in vain to be good enough for him, not knowing I could never make the payment for my sin. But God in heaven came to me, he used the spirit sword. He answered all my questions in his word. Nothing but the blood for me to take away my sin. I kneel beneath the fountain that cleanses deep within. Nothing but the blood for me, the past erasing flood of justice and mercy, found in nothing but the blood. My heart is yielded to his call, my soul has found its wings, my mind is drinking in the peace that knowing brings. Still many grope in emptiness, a place I live so long. If only they could sing with me this song. Nothing but the blood for me to take away my sin. I kneel beneath the fountain that cleanses deep within. Nothing but the blood for me, the past erasing flood of justice and mercy, found in nothing but the blood.
Wash away my sin.
Would you be free from your burden of sin?
Nothing but the blood for me to take away my sin. I kneel beneath the fountain that cleanses deep within. Nothing but the blood for me, the past erasing flood of justice and mercy, found in nothing but the blood.
By Margaret Peterson Haddix, famines have ravaged the country. Sadly, population laws restrict each family to only 2 children. The population police capture and remove 3rd children that are found. Luke Garner is a 3rd child who stays indoors all the time. However, Luke discovers another 3rd child, Jen Talbot. She is his neighbor and has gone to a rally for 3rd children. Luke has not heard from her since she's left. He decides to sneak into her house to see what has happened to her. However, he is discovered by a man. Hi, my name is Josie Schaefer. I attend Fairview Christian Academy. I'm in the 10th grade, and today I will be reciting an excerpt from Among the Hidden by Margaret Peterson Haddix. Luke stifled his instinct to run, but he recognized the object pointed at him from books and Dad's descriptions. This gun was smaller, meant to kill humans, Luke looked to the man holding it. Luke had seen him only from a distance before. You're Jen's dad. The man snapped.
Who are you?
Friend of Jen's. Please, I just want to know where she is.
How do you know about Jen?
I'm a third child too. I'm a neighbor. I found out about her and I started coming over when I could.
How did you know she was here?
I saw lights when I knew everyone was gone. I guess I really wanted there to be another third child for me to meet. The man sat in the chair by the computer desk and rested the gun on his leg.
Did Jen teach you how to disable our alarm system?
Yes, but I must have messed up since you came.
No, if you'd messed up, the security guards would have come. But I have it set so I'm automatically notified if the system shut down while I'm away. Given the circumstances, I decided to investigate myself.
Luke longed to ask what circumstances he meant.
So what else did you and Jen do together?
We talked a lot. She showed me the computer. She wanted me to go to the rally, but I was too scared.
Why didn't you stop her?
Stop Jen? That's like trying to stop the sun. The man gave Luke the faintest of smiles, one that contained no happiness.
Just remember that, he said.
So, where is she?
Jen!
His voice broke.
Jen is no longer with us. She's dead!
Somehow Luke had known. He still stumbled backwards in shock. He bumped into the couch and sagged into it. No. Not Jen, no, you're lying! His ears roared. He thought crazy things. This was a nightmare. How could she be dead? It was impossible. The man was shaking his head helplessly.
I'd give anything to have her back. But it's true. They gave us the body. We couldn't tell anyone why we were walking around with red eyes, aching hearts. No, we just had to pretend to be the same old family we'd always been.
They shot her. They shot all of them. All 40 kids at that rally. Luke started shaking his head no. Jen said there'd be too many to shoot. She said there'd be 1,000. I told her I couldn't go. It's not my fault.
No, and you couldn't have stopped her. It's not your fault.
Tears began to spill down Jen's father's face.
What I don't understand is why. Why did she do this? This children's crusade. We had been warning her about the population police all her life. Did she really think this rally would work?
Yes, Luke assured him. There was something in Jen that made her willing to sacrifice herself to help others, or try to. I think at first she thought the rally would work. And then, even when she wasn't sure, she still had to go. She wouldn't call it off.
Why?
He was sobbing.
Did she want to die?
No.
She wanted to live. Not die. Not hide. Live.
Not die, not hide, live.
The words played over and over again in his brain. As long as he held on to them, he felt like Jen was there. He could believe that it was her voice echoing in his ears.
Like something's a-brewing, about to begin.
Can't put my finger on what lies in store.
But I feel it's to happen.
All happened before.
Good evening. We are the middle school choir speaking group from Fairview Christian Academy in Athens, Tennessee.
And we will be performing an excerpt from Mary Poppins, written by P.L. Travers.
Chapter 1, East Wind. If you want to find Cherry Tree Lane, all you have to do is ask the policeman at the crossroads. He will push his helmet slightly to one side,
scratch his head thoughtfully,
and then he will point his huge white glove finger and say,
first to your right, second to your left, sharp right again,
and you're there. And sure enough, if you follow his directions exactly, you will be there, right in the middle of Cherry Tree Lane, where the houses run down one side, and the park runs down the other, and the cherry trees go dancing right down the middle.
If you're looking for number 17,
and it's more than likely that you will be,
you will very soon find it.
It's the smallest house in the lane,
and besides that,
it's the only one that is rather dilapidated and needs a coat of paint. But Mr. Banks, who owns it, said to Mrs. Banks that she could either have a
nice, clean,
comfortable house,
or four children.
But not both, for he cannot afford it.
Well, Mr. Banks went off with his black bag.
And Mrs. Banks went into the drawing room and sat there all day long, writing letters to the paper and begging them to send some pennies to her at once. And upstairs in the nursery, Jane and Michael watched out the window and wondered who would come.
They were glad Katie Nana had gone,
for they had never liked her. She was old and fat and smelled of barley water. Anything would be better than Katie Nana,
if not much better.
After supper, Jane and Michael sat at the window, watching for Mr. Banks to come and listening to the sound of the east wind.
There he is!
There he is!
There he is!
Said Michael, pointing to a shape that banged heavily against the gate.
That's not Daddy,
she said.
It's somebody else.
Then the shape tossed and bent under the wind
and lifted the latch of the gate.
And they could see that it belonged to a woman who was holding her hat with one hand and carrying a bag in the other.
As they watched, Jane and Michael saw a curious thing happen.
As soon as the shape was inside the gate, the wind seemed to catch her and fling her. The watching children heard a terrific bang, and as she landed, the whole house shook.
How funny. I've never seen that happen before.
Said Michael.
Let's go see who it is.
Said Jane.
Presently, they saw their mother with the visitor following her.
Jane and Michael could see that the newcomer had shiny black hair, and that she was thin, with large feet and hands, and small, rather peering blue eyes.
You will find that they are very nice children,
Mrs. Banks said.
Michael's elbow gave a sharp dig into Jane's ribs, and that they give no trouble at all,
continued Mrs. Banks uncertainly, as if she herself really didn't believe what she was saying. They heard the visitor sniff as though she didn't either.
Mrs. Banks led the way towards the staircase, talking all the time, without stopping once.
And because she was doing that, Mrs. Banks did not notice what was happening behind her. But Jane and Michael, watching from the top of the landing, had an excellent view of an extraordinary thing the visitor now did. Certainly she followed Mrs. Banks upstairs,
but
same time as Mrs. Banks. Such a thing Jane and Michael knew had never been done before. Down, of course, but up, never!
Why, children,
said Mrs. Banks, noticing them suddenly.
What are you doing there? This is your new nurse, Mary Poppins. Jane, Michael, say how do you do?
Mary Poppins regarded them steadily, looking from one to the other, as though she were making up her mind whether she liked them or not.
Will we do?
Said Michael. Mary Poppins continued to regard the four children searchingly. Then, with a long, loud sniff
that seemed to indicate she had made up her mind,
she said, I'll take the position.
Hi, my name is Tanner Harrell, and I'm from Fairview Christian Academy, and I will be presenting The America I Grew Up In by Jeff Allen. I had the pleasure of growing up in America before the lawyers took it over and ruined it on us. Yeah, in my day, if a kid fell off the monkey bars and chipped the bone in his arm, that was tragic. But it sure was funny to the rest of us, and it certainly wasn't reason to take the monkey bars off the playgrounds. We all did dumb things. That's how you learn not to do dumb things. C.S. Lewis said, suffering was God's megaphone. That's right. You do dumb things, it hurts, and you learn not to do it. I'll give you an example. When I was 12, a girl told me to get a ball canning jar, find some dry ice, put it in the jar, and put the lid on it. So I said, what's gonna happen? It's gonna blow up. Cool! Where do I get dry ice at? The ice cream man. Duh. So one day, I heard the ice cream man coming down my street, and I run out with one of my mother's cannon jars, and I asked, you got any dry ice? Ice cream man says, what you gonna do with it? I'm gonna put it in this jar, put the lid on it, and it's gonna explode. Oh, here's your dry ice, kid. That's the America I grew up in. And yes, of course, that night, my mother was at our kitchen table, picking shards of glass out of my forehead. My father came walking in. How'd that happen? Somebody told me to find some dry ice and put it in a ball jar and it'll blow up.
So, knowing that, you were just sitting there, staring at the jar, waiting for it to blow up right in your face.
Yep! What am I raising, a moron? I could see why you'd think that. And I never did it again, because then that would have been really dumb. That's how you learn. Okay, another example. My nephew's coming by. This poor kid's 11 years old. I look at him. Where's he going? My sister says, rollerblading. I thought he was gonna disarm a nuclear device. Poor kid looked like the Michelin Man. Foam, rubber, plastic, everywhere. She says, I don't want him to get hurt. Hurt? The kid could take a semi at 80 miles an hour in that outfit. Falling on concrete is supposed to hurt. That's your incentive to stay upright on the roller. They've ruined everything. For instance, playgrounds. I took my granddaughter to a playground. What happened to playgrounds? The slide is 5 feet high and made out of plastic. She would go 4 inches and stop. 4 inches and stop. 4 inches and stop. That's not a slide, it's a scoot.
Weep, Papa! Weep, Papa! Weep, Papa! What did we have? We had a six-story-high solid steel structure. Yeah, by mid-July with a temperature of about 285 degrees, you lose 2 layers of skin on the way down and 1 when you hit the ground like a flat rock on a pond. Boom, 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 boom. Come back picking gravel out of your thighs. No, but now it's wee, Papa, wee, Papa, wee, Papa. I wanted to shove her down the slide. I did. I wanted to shove her so she'd know that exhilarating feeling of sliding. And then I felt 6 iPhones on my back. Go ahead, old man. We dare ya. It's nuts. Car seats. I'm not against car seats. I'm just telling you, I'm tired of strapping my granddaughter in like a NASCAR driver to go 2 miles down the road to get a Diet Coke from the mini mart. She's 54 pounds. I'm gonna get a hernia hauling her in and out of the seat. What age can you take them out now? 5, 7, 18? Here's your high school diploma. You get a ride home like a big boy today. I mean, come on, car seats. I walked the back seat of my mother's car for 4 years. She'd be driving and I'd just be walking side to side. And sure, every now and then, she'd hit the brakes, and I'd fly up into the front, and she'd toss me back like a trout. What are you doing up here? Get back there! I got pulled over by the police. I'm not making this up. I got pulled over by the police because it was a sunny day, and my granddaughter was in the back seat. And the policeman said, I'm not gonna write you up this time, but you need to have a sunshade to protect her from the sun. I go, what? Are you kidding? Since when did the sun become this evil thing? I mean, come on, sunscreen? We didn't have sunscreen when I was a kid. You know what sunscreen was? Dirt. You wanna know why? Cause we'd eat the dirt and it'd get all over our face and protect us from the sun. And then we'd wash it down with water from a garden hose, and I'd take a bath, put on my expensive pajamas, and go to bed. Look how I turned out.
Well, that concludes our program for this evening. I believe all these young people deserve another round of applause, so if we could do that tonight. As you can tell, a lot of work and effort, practice, and hours went in to what was performed tonight. I encourage you to pray for these young people. They'll be headed to state competition, the majority of them, in just a couple of weeks. They're excited about that, and they've put a lot of effort into that in order to perform and do their very best, and I'm excited for them. As we say often, I love sports. I love everything that our school does, the academics. But all these things that you saw tonight are things that in the future they'll be able to use for the Lord as they sing, as they speak. And I'm so proud of all those who put the effort and the work into what they did tonight, and I just want to thank them for it. But each time we do this as well, often the kids get up here and they get all the attention. Everybody sees them, but there's many hours that goes into this behind the scenes, and especially with 5 different people in this room tonight who have put a lot of hours and time and effort into these speeches, to these songs, the music that was performed tonight. We want to thank them as well, and I want to recognize them as well this evening. 3 of our teachers who worked with these particular things on the songs and the speeches. Mrs. Anderson, we want to thank her tonight and all the effort that she put in to the program. Ms. Harrell as well, and we're thankful for their work and effort there. And then we want to thank Brother Kyle and his effort with our singing, our music groups. And then 2 individuals who worked very hard on our piano pieces as well for these groups. We want to thank Mrs. Brown in the back and then Mrs. Harrell in the front. And we want to give all of them a round of applause tonight as well. But I appreciate them. I know even in my own home, they put a lot of effort and time into all the things that take place that you see tonight. And I appreciate the extra hours that they spend working, preparing, and helping these young people to perform. So I encourage you to let them know how much you appreciate them, and let them know how much we're thankful for the hours that they put in to help these students do their very best. I'm thankful for Christian Education. I'm thankful for Fairview Christian Academy. And I appreciate you allowing us to work with your young people day in and day out. And I pray that these things that they learn and even these performances will be things that will further their character and, most importantly, further their Christian walk with the Lord as they learn discipline and they learn to serve Him as well. And I'm thankful for all the songs, how they pointed to the Savior, and just so many things that are done tonight that uplifted the name of Christ. So I appreciate you allowing us to work with your young people, and I pray that in the days ahead, God will use us alongside of you, as we say often, and as on the walls you walk in to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And I pray that you see that each and every day in the lives of your students. We want to dismiss in a word of prayer. So if you want to stand to your feet tonight, we'll dismiss in a word of prayer. I appreciate you being here tonight and participating in this fine arts night. And again, encourage you to pray for these students. You can come take some pictures afterwards if you'd like. But again, thank you for being here, and we appreciate your attendance at this event. Let's pray this evening. Lord, we thank you tonight for just your blessings upon us. We thank you for Fairview Christian Academy. And Lord, I thank you for these students and all the effort and work they put in to this presentation tonight. I pray that you go before them as they go to state competition. I pray you'd calm their nerves, help them to do their very best, that they can leave that day knowing that they performed their best and gave you their best effort and honored you in all that they said and did. And Lord, I just pray that you'd be with these teachers, and I thank you for the effort and the work that they put into our students. And I just pray that these would be things that they learn for eternity, the disciplines that they've learned, the things that they've understood on how to just honor you with all that they say and do. And Lord, I just pray tonight that you just bless our school, our church, and I just pray in the days ahead that these students would grow up to be adults that would serve and honor you with their lives, even as we have on the wall behind us that we are desires to magnify the Lord in all that we do and say. And I just pray tonight I did exactly that, that your name was glorified in all that was said and done. Thank you for these parents and these families that are represented in this room. And I just pray that we can be a blessing to them as we work alongside them to bring up disciples of Christ. God, guide us as we leave here. Bless the remainder of this week. May you just be pleased by all we say and do. For it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you again for being here, and good night.